Hey guys, it's Drew from Central United Methodist. And the King will say, I tell you the truth. When you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it to me. That's Matthew chapter 25, verse 40. In this next series for Central Youth, we will be talking about what it means to go against the grain of what society says is right, and instead jumping into life by audaciously leading with love. Will you dare to be rebellious? I'll see you Wednesday. Hey guys, I'm Drew Herring, the Director of Student Ministries at Central United Methodist, and it is finally time to register for Breakthrough again. Breakthrough is the best spiritual retreat for students I have ever seen. We have a table outside so you can register, and I'll see you out there. Hey guys, it's Drew from Central United Methodist, and the King will say, I tell you the truth. When you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it to me. That's Matthew chapter 25, verse 40. In this next series for Central Youth, we will be talking about what it means to go against the grain of what society says is right, and instead jumping into life by audaciously leading with love. Will you dare to be rebellious? I'll see you Wednesday.
Trust in horses, some may trust in chariots, oh, but I'm gonna trust in the name of the Lord. Some trust in their riches, some may trust in all they own. Oh, but I will trust in the name of the Lord.
And the king will say, I tell you the truth,
resurrection
power,
bondage breaking power in his name,
there's
power in his name. Mountains above, you are where my help is from.
Hey guys, I'm Drew Herring, the Director of Student Ministries at Central United Methodist, and it is finally time to register for Breakthrough again. Breakthrough is the best spiritual retreat for students I have ever seen. We have a table outside so you can register, and I'll see you out there.
opened the prison. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. Let's sing it. They're joy in the house of the Lord. They're joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out the praise. They're joy in the house of the Lord.
We have endured these past few years and know that there is more to face before us. We don't know if we have the strength to withstand what might be around the next corner, and we wonder who will stand with us, who will have our back, who will occupy our corner.
Who is with us that we begin to wonder? That is what we begin to wonder these days. Who will light our way and chart our course? Who is on our side? Who will welcome us home again?
Home. The prophet Jeremiah speaks of a branch that will be raised. Jesus spoke of a son of man that will descend. Both point to a hope that calls us home, our true home, where we're welcomed and loved and included, where there's justice and equality and peace. It's time, this Advent season, time to go home.
We light this candle as a sign of our hope, our strong hope that there is a way to go home, to the home in Christ, and it starts with us here and it starts now. It's time to go home.
Good morning, Central. We welcome you this morning, whether you are here or whether you are joining us online. Jimmy said something last week in his sermon that really resonated with me. He talked about that while Thanksgiving was not a religious holiday, that it was a time that no matter what your denomination, what your religion, we had an opportunity here in the United States to come together and express our gratitude and thankfulness. That just kind of stuck with me all week. And then here we celebrate today, our first Sunday of Advent. That's kind of on the heels of being thankful, because for us as Christians, this is the thing that we have the most to be thankful for, that God sent his child as a baby to save us from ourselves. So we welcome you this morning as we begin with our first Sunday of Advent. Before we start our worship, we have a few announcements. We have some sympathies, and one of those is to the family of Regina Myatt, who passed away on November the 21st. She was the wife, mother, and grandmother to Dr. Ray Myatt, Dr. Nathan, and Heather Myatt, and their families. We express our sympathies for that. Yesterday, we celebrated the life of Paul Davis. That is the husband of Beverly Davis. He passed away this week, and we offer our sympathies to Beverly and to the Goldman family. I would like to remind you that next week at our traditional worship at 11 o'clock, we will celebrate Christmas with a special service. I'm going to give you a little hint, too. You really don't want to miss it. While it's a very special service, we also have the opportunity for our Kinder choir to sing. So don't miss that. I promise you, you will be blessed as we begin to celebrate this season of Advent.
We really have so much to be thankful for, don't we? Put our hope in Jesus. He's done so much for us.
I've been healed by a Savior. I feel far from above. I've been down to that river. Like a saint, the prodigal's return.
Now sing with us.
Well, all my hope is in Jesus. Thank God my yesterday's gone. Oh, I'm no stranger to a prison. I've worn shackles and chains,
but I've been free.
I've been freed and forgiven. I'm not going back. I'll never be.
Everybody sing it.
Yeah. wrecks him down to his knees. But God had been broken down more than a time or two. Yes, I have. But then you picked me up and showed me what it means to be a man. That's always singing, oh, my hope is in Jesus. Thank God my yesterday is gone. Oh, my sins are forgiven. Oh, and I've been washed by the blood. One more time, sing it with us. Oh, my hope is in Jesus. Yes, it is.
Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, grant us this Advent season your divine grace. Each and every one of us is ultimately a thought of God, our Creator. We have at times become a distorted and somewhat unrecognizable one, but nevertheless, a thought of God. Help us to be more like Jesus and see in one another, even in our enemies, the pearl that lies sometimes deep in the mire of our sin. Jesus came to bestow on us the priceless gift of a love so great that he could release the pearl within us all and bring us back into fellowship with God. We pray this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Y'all sit or stand as you feel called to do. We sing about a God of wonders.
We've seen what you can do, oh God of wonders. Your power has no end. The things you've done before, in greater measure, we know you will do again. 'Cause there's no prison wall that you can break.
That's right. There's no broken.
There's no broken body you can raise. No soul that you won't save. All things are possible.
I'm not used to how bright those lights are. I'm sorry. It kind of just took me by surprise. Good Sunday morning and welcome to Central. We're so glad to have you worshiping with us today here at the church. For those of you that may not know me, maybe you're joining us for the first time either in person or online. I'm Matt Farmer, the associate pastor here at Central, and it's my great joy and honor to be sharing with you this morning from God's Word on this first Sunday of Advent. I know that this time of year is a really busy time for all of us. There are events to attend, tasks to be completed, but I want to thank you this morning for taking the time to prioritize your relationship with God and for being with us here today. This morning, we're going to begin a new series entitled The Carols of Christmas. And each Sunday in Advent, we're going to be looking at a different carol, examining what those time-honored songs can speak to us today. If you have your Bibles with you or the Bible app on your phone, I want to invite you to go ahead and turn to the book of 2 Samuel in the Old Testament, chapter number 7. If you don't have your Bible or the Bible app on your phone, don't worry, the scripture will be behind me on the screens. And as you're turning there, I want to give you a quick reminder or two about some events coming up here at the church. This afternoon at 4 p.m. in the gym on 11th Street, we're going to have our annual Advent Fair. If you're not sure what this is, let me give you a quick overview. Advent Fair is a time of fellowship and fun and crafts that kicks off the Advent season. It's especially great for families and for kids, so we invite you to come out and have some fun with us. Enjoy a time together. For those of you that have attended Advent year in years past, you know that this is one of those events you just don't want to miss. It's a lot of fun, a lot of neat keepsakes for you parents and even grandparents, aunts and uncles. You can just give these things away, keep what you like. The ones that you're not so fond of, you can gift. I mean, you know, because 'tis the season, right? Also, this coming Saturday, December the 4th, the church is going to be open during the annual Meridian Christmas Parade. For those of you that might be worried about a football game, I hear it's a big deal. I'm not a football guy. I just like watching a good game, but I know Pastor Jimmy has already asked. We're going to show the football game here in the fellowship hall, so don't worry. If you're worried about missing it, come on. Enjoy it. A time of refreshments. I think we're going to have hot chocolate, nachos, popcorn, things like that. There's no entrance fee or cover charge, anything like that to come. Just come and enjoy a time together and just fellowship, because that's what part of this season is about, is joining together with those of like mind. So with those announcements out of the way, let's turn now to our text in 2 Samuel in chapter 7. I'm going to start reading at verse 1. And if you're able, please stand this morning in honor of the reading of God's Word. When the king was settled in his house and the Lord had given him rest from all of his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I'm living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go tell my servant David, thus saith the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought my people up out of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people, saying, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, 'Thus saith the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, to be a prince over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you went. I have cut off your enemies from before you, and I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones on earth. And I will appoint a place for my people of Israel, and I will plant them so that they will live in their own place and be disturbed no more. And evildoers shall afflict them no more as formerly. From the time I have appointed judges over my people Israel, I will give them rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house.'" Now skipping ahead to verse 16, it says, "Your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me, and your throne shall be established forever." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated this morning. If you'll just bear with me one moment, I'm using technology this morning, which means that I need to adjust the setting so this doesn't go off in the middle of it, and it messed me up. But anyway, While I'm doing this, I want you to think for a moment about maybe a time where things didn't go just as you had planned. I know you can probably think of this. I want you to be able to just relive those emotions you felt with that in a minute. We're going to get to that, I promise. And it's going to make sense. And I think you'll be able to follow along with what I'm saying this morning. But this passage this morning, you may be wondering, how in the world does this have anything to do with Christmas? And we're going to get there, I promise. But as I mentioned, we are starting a new series. And this morning, the carol that we focus on in this series, The Carols of Christmas, is the one by the title, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. And while I can't speak for you, for me, this Christmas hymn, it's a favorite of mine. Because to me, the melody of this song is eerily beautiful, due in part to the fact that there are these minor chords in the music. But the song itself just almost carries this air of reservation about it. In the first verse of this song, we sing the words, O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel, so that mourns in lonely exile here until the Son of God appears. And while these words were written well after the birth of Christ, I can't help but wonder if maybe, just maybe, something similar was said in the prayers of the people, those awaiting the Messiah around the time that Jesus was born. Certainly they would have prayed for the fulfillment of a promise of a coming king, one who would restore the kingdom of Israel and deliver her from her enemies. However, I also can't help but believe that there must have been some apprehension when the word of the Messiah's birth came to them in those days. Because you see, they were hoping for a king, but what they got was a needy baby. A baby born under questionable circumstances to an unwed virgin and her fiancé. And there must have been this range of emotions upon hearing this news, because after all, this wasn't what they had hoped for or what they had planned on. I want to take a quick poll this morning. I asked you just a minute ago to think of a time when things didn't go according to plan. How many of you were able to think of something? Can I see a hand? Come on, don't be shy. I'm just going to go ahead and say this. If you didn't raise your hand, I know you're probably lying, and that's okay. God is a God of grace. But if you raised your hand this morning, you know that when this happens, it's a complete letdown. When things don't go how we had planned it, it's a complete letdown. Maybe you've mapped out all the details of your situation, and you knew what was going to happen, and you knew the ideal time for each moment to take place. You know just who would be included in the plans that you made. And maybe, if you're like my wife, you picked out the perfect outfit. Right? I heard some laughing. I know that some of you are there. That's okay. Here's the thing, friends. I could stand up here this morning and I could speculate for the entire time that I have with you this morning about what plans you might have made and how they messed up, but I'm not going to do that. But I do, however, want you to think about the time when those things didn't go according to plan, and I want you to consider for just a moment how you felt when all of those well-laid plans began to crumble around you. Did you feel anger? Did you feel sadness or frustration? Whatever emotion it was that you felt, I want you to take just a few moments and remember that. Now, I don't want you to grab a hold to it and just gnaw on it throughout the service, but I almost want that emotion just to kind of rise up and you'd be like, mm-mm, we're not going to go there again, because I want you to understand just what it does whenever things that we have planned don't go our way. And while you're doing that, while you're thinking about it, I want to share with you a time that things didn't go how I had planned. But I want to preface this story by telling you that I'm not telling this story for sympathy, but instead I'm sharing it with you because I believe that when I share this story with others, there's much needed healing that takes place for me. 7 years ago tomorrow was Saturday, November 29th. The year was 2014, and it was my birthday. Yes, I expect happy birthdays after this, but you know. Now, for those of you that don't, here's another thing. If you don't have a birthday near a holiday, I want to just go ahead and be the first to tell you just how awesome that really is. Because family is typically in town for the holiday, right? For me, it was Thanksgiving, which means that your birthday is always going to be top-notch because you're going to see aunts and uncles and people that you haven't seen for a while, and they're going to show up with cards, even though it's a couple days before your birthday, and they're going to hand you those cards. And when I was younger, some of those cards had like a $5 bill in it or a dollar bill or something, and that was really awesome, you know. And it's kind of hard for somebody to forget your birthday when it's around a holiday because they associate the holiday with your birthday. And while they may not remember the exact day that you were born, they think, oh, such and such holiday is coming up. I better send Matt a card. It's great. Seriously, I'm telling you, it's great. If those of you that don't agree with me, it's fine. You don't have to. But if you really think of it in the way that I do, because I'm big about celebrating me on my birthday, it's a great thing. So November 29th, 2014, in my mind, was going to be no exception. This was going to be an awesome time because my sister was in town with her husband and her family from North Carolina. And that evening, we had plans to go out and celebrate me. And it's kind of a tradition in our family that when we go out to eat for a birthday, the birthday person gets to pick and nobody else can complain about it, right? And now my wife can attest to you that this is a big deal for me, but really and truly, the whole month of November is a big deal for me because I celebrate my birthday month all in November. If you don't celebrate a birthday month, I encourage you to do so. It's really amazing because you can celebrate yourself all year long, and all month long. You could do it all year. I mean, you know, some of us do that. I've preached about that before, that we have a really easy time pleasing ourselves. But yeah, I said all month because I do celebrate all November long. My wife can't stand it because, you know, I tell her you get to celebrate your whole birthday month until your birthday, and then you have to stop celebrating. And her birthday is January 7th, so she only gets a little while of a birthday month. But anyhow, we're not going to get on that because I'll sleep on the couch. But I hope that you're getting the idea this morning, though, about how much I was anticipating this day 7 years ago. And, you know, because of what I had planned out in my mind, it makes this next part all the more difficult. Because my phone rang around 8:30 in the morning, and I looked at the caller ID, because we all have that nowadays, and it was my mom. And we were actually just kind of chilling around the house, and I looked at Tiffany, and I said, oh, Tiffany's mom, she probably wants to be the first person to wish me a happy birthday on my birthday. But unfortunately, I couldn't have been more wrong. Because with a shaky voice, my mom began to tell me that my papa had passed away that morning. And suddenly I found myself in a completely different state of mind. All the plans I had made, they flew out the door. And instead of going over to my folks' house that day to celebrate with family, I went to mourn and remember a great man that made a huge impact on my life. And in all candor this morning, it's taken me years to get to the place where I can share this experience with others. Because it was for me the moment in my life when the reality of everything around me really set in, because I understood on that day that even my best laid, most anticipated plans were fragile and fleeting. Now, maybe you've had an experience like that brought you to that realization in life. And this morning, I can't help but think that this portion of scripture that we read about King David did the same thing for him so many years ago. Because David had come to a place in his reign where he was comfortable. In fact, our scripture this morning said that he had settled and that God had given him rest from his enemies. It even says that David had been gifted a house. In this portion of our scripture, it follows where David had been set up as king and had brought the Ark of the Covenant to Jerusalem. In fact, in 2 Samuel chapter 5, verses 10 and 12, or through 12 rather, it says, "And David became greater and greater, for the Lord, the God of hosts, was with him." And then it says, "King Hiram sent messengers to David along with cedar trees and carpenters and masons who built David a house. And David perceived that the Lord had established him king over Israel and that he exalted his kingdom for the sake of the people of Israel." Now this portion of the text tells us that David's growing greater. Why is he growing greater? Because God was with him. And he's grown so much in his power and in his reign that another king, King Hiram of Tyre, he recognizes what's going on and he says, you know what, I'm going to send over the wood. Cedar was a big deal back then. If you had a house of cedar, you were considered royalty. So he says, I'm going to send a gift of cedar, a gift of carpenters, a gift of masons, and I want them to go and to build David a house. In chapter 6, it details what David did then to bring the Ark of the Covenant to Jerusalem, where his house has been built. And our text this morning tells us that he's ready to shore up his reign as king. Because all of this stuff had happened. People were starting to recognize him. He's been gifted a house, and suddenly he believes, hey, I've got to do something to kind of shore up what's going on here. But how is he going to do it? Walter Brueggemann, a theologian and author of the Interpretation Commentary on 1 and 2 Samuel, answers this by reminding us of this here in his work. It says, the obvious answer to the problem of legitimacy of every ruler in the ancient Near East is to build a temple. Because giving God a permanent residence would solidify the regime. Now this understanding, it helps us see why David was set on building a house for God. But Brueggemann further states that the act of temple building is undoubtedly a mixed act of genuine piety, but also self-serving legitimation. Because building a temple for God would legitimize David's reign as king, but also hopefully it would be seen as an act of worship by the others in his kingdom. So David, what does he do? He shares this grand idea with Nathan. And Nathan is one of his advisors. He's a prophet of God. And in verse 3 of chapter 7, Nathan tells David this. He hears David's plan and he basically says, you know what, David? Build the temple because you want to know why God is with you. And you know, I can't help but think of David and think that at these words out of Nathan's mouth, that he was kind of pleased with himself. You know, he was like, yeah, I'm going to build that temple. But later that night, things begin to change because God, he speaks to Nathan and he says, I have other plans for David. And Nathan, I need you to tell him what they are. And this is where things get interesting because in this dialogue that we have between Nathan and God, God begins talking about a house, but the meaning of that word house begins to change. The study notes in the Wesley Study Bible put it this way. David uses the word house in a physical sense, while the Lord starts to use it in a metaphorical sense. You see, David is so intently focused on building an actual physical temple that God has to repeat himself several times because God's intent is on building David's house or his legacy. God isn't so much concerned with a dwelling place that David has in mind. He's concerned with building David's royal lineage. And this, my friends, this snippet here is the key to understanding this entire passage this morning. Because while David had great plans for God's house, God had other plans in store for David's house. And this is important for us to stand because in this unlikely situation, God is setting the stage for the coming Messiah. In this portion of Scripture, it's known by many Bible students and maybe even by yourself as the Davidic covenant. And it's this passage that God begins to explain his covenantal plans for David. And this plan is summed up by the last verse we read this morning, verse 16. Alton H. McEachern put it best in his essay about our passage this morning when he said this, this passage became the source of messianic hope that God's anointed would establish his rule on earth. God tells David in this verse that, that David's family is going to rule forever over Israel. And Israel, you'll remember, is God's chosen people. And you may be sitting there wondering, preacher, where in the world are you going with this? What does this have to do with Christmas? Well, I'm glad you asked because I'm going to wrap it up here for you here in just a second. You see, another theologian, Timothy F. Simpson, writes that the promise that a descendant of David would always sit on the throne made in 2 Samuel 7, it had long since been gone off course by the time that Mary comes on the scene. And we're all familiar with the story of Joseph and Mary. But if we look at Luke's gospel account, we see that it points out the connection of David and Jesus. In verse 32 of chapter 1, you can go back and read it. It says this. It says, he, Jesus, will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him a throne of his ancestor, David. So the lineage of Jesus is so significant that Luke has to point out that, hey, this guy, Jesus, he's from the family of David.
But Matthew does the same thing. He gives this long lineage because he begins his gospel with it, and it details all of these people, these 14 generations, and it ends with Jesus. And friends, that information, it shows us that this covenantal plan that God spoke of to Nathan is true. And like David, those living during the time of Jesus' birth, they had other plans for what was actually going on at that time. They had other plans for what this Messiah might look like. It was no secret they were looking for a Messiah that would restore the kingdom of Israel. And the Lexham Theological Word Book says this about the idea of the coming Messiah in the Old Testament. I want to read this to you. It says, "The idea of a king from a Davidic line of kings, fueled by the hope that God would finally send a kingly figure to deliver Israel from her enemies and establish his reign on earth," it had to make the people think that this Messiah would be a kingly figure that wouldn't only rule Israel, but one whom God would say, "I will make you," or to you, "the nations as your heritage, and your possessions will be to the ends of the earth." So the Old Testament's theme of this ideal king is therefore a seed of which that we see all messianic hope growing from. And understanding this, we see that Christ, the child that was born to an unwed mother in a stable, it really didn't fit the bill as a kingly Messiah. Especially not how they saw it in the Old Testament. But friends, what those people forgot, and admittedly what we oftentimes forget, is that God's ways aren't always our ways. And while we may not understand what his plan is in the moment, we can rest assured that out of the unexpected comes something marvelous. And I wonder this morning, do we truly expect the unexpected today in our relationship with God? When we're singing the words of this timeless hymn, O come, Emmanuel, and we're asking Christ to be present in our lives, are we looking for him to have his way? Or are we looking for him to simply be conformed to our ways and our ideas? Friends, during the season of Advent, when we celebrate the long-expected Messiah, are we actually prepared to accept what his plans are over our own? Because when the people that were living during the time of Jesus' birth saw that this news of the Messiah, this wasn't what they had planned on. This looked nothing like what they had hoped for. And they had to be willing to accept that God's plans may be different. And I believe this morning that the tendency among Christ followers today is this attempt to paint God into a box that's contrived by our own desires. And like King David, we may have made these elaborate plans and we want God to be a part of our plans, yet we fail to understand that our plans, friends, our ideas, our everything that we could lay out, it pales in comparison to what God's plans are for our life. And this morning, I don't want you to think that what I'm saying to you is negative, because the purpose of this sermon isn't to condemn you, but to encourage you. Because, friends, the fact that God's plans are greater than ours, it's the good news that I want you to grab hold of and hear this morning. And I need you to know, friends, that there's joy and there's comfort in the unexpected when the unexpected comes from God. And that bears repeating this morning. There's joy and comfort in the unexpected when that unexpected comes from Almighty God. So this morning, on the first Sunday of Advent, I want to ask you this question. And it's pretty simple. It's, are you looking for the unexpected this Christmas? In other words, when you prayerfully sing, O come Emmanuel, because you want the Messiah in your life, is it that you want him there so he'll fit in your mold? Or is it that you want him there so that he would break every mold and overwhelm you with the unexpectedness of his plan for your life in the coming year? Friends, the hope that we find in Jesus, it comes from an unexpected beginning. Because without the coming of a baby in a manger so many years ago, we would have nothing to celebrate. Because it was from this unexpected that we find our hope. And it continues to be the unexpected that brings us in line with God's will for our lives. So this year, this Christmas, may we truly desire His unexpected plans and wisdom as we sing these words in this song. O come, thou wisdom from on high, and order all things far and nigh. To us the path of knowledge show, and cause us in her ways to go. Rejoice today, my friends, because you have hope, because Emmanuel has come. Let me pray for you this morning. Gracious, great, and loving Father, thank you. Thank you for working in the unexpected. God, we praise you that so many years ago an unexpected plan brought hope to a dark world. And God, as we begin our Advent journey this morning, I pray that you would help us look for the unexpected this Christmas season. Lord, may our desire be not that you be conformed to what we have come up with, but that you would blow us away with something we never thought possible. God, your ways are always higher. Your ways are always more meaningful. God, help us to grab hold to that hope this morning. The only true hope that we have in Jesus Christ, your Son. Lord, if there's any here this morning that do not know you, God, I pray that you would speak to their heart even now. Lord, that today might be the day that they find salvation, that they find hope in you and your Son, Jesus. Maybe there are those struggling here this morning, financially, in their marriage and relationships. God, whatever it is, Lord, help them find hope in the unexpected. They may not see a way out, but with you, there's always an amazing, marvelous way if we would just look for your ways, God, and not try to fit you into the box that we've come up with. Lord, speak to your people this morning. Help them to remember, God, the reason we celebrate came from something so unexpected so many years ago. And it continues to amaze us this day. We'll be sure to give you the glory and praise. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Well, friends, at this time, we give back in continuation of our worship of God by giving back that He's blessed us with, a portion of that at least. And we do that so that ministry can continue to go forth from this place. And we're all called to be a part of that. You know, we're given the opportunity. It's not something that's forced upon us. God says He wants you to give cheerfully. He wants you to give back a portion so that you can take part in His bigger plan. And so this morning, this is what we ask you to do as our ushers come. You know, we ask you just to give cheerfully and give back to God. Friends, if you need to pray this morning, feel free to come down and pray as we sing this final song. But worship with us this morning as we give and as we sing.
Yeah.
just this. Oh God, I need you.
My prayer is that you mean that this morning. That you understand that you need God. More than your next breath, you need Him, because His unexpected way, when you've tried it your way so many times and you've hit a brick wall after brick wall after brick wall, if you'll just turn to Him and allow Him to work in the unexpected in your life, friends, something marvelous can happen. So go forth this morning from this place in peace and in the courage of Jesus Christ, who brings hope into the world. May the Holy Spirit be with you. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen.
Hey guys, it's Drew from Central United Methodist, and the King will say, I tell you the truth, when you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it to me. That's Matthew chapter 25, verse 40. In this next series for Central Youth, we will be talking about what it means to go against the grain of what society says is right, and instead jumping into life by audaciously leading with love. Will you dare to be rebellious? I'll see you Wednesday. Hey guys, I'm Drew Herring, the Director of Student Ministries at Central United Methodist, and it is finally time to register for Breakthrough again. Breakthrough is the best spiritual retreat for students I have ever seen. We have a table outside so you can register, and I'll see you out there.
There are people who do not have enough to eat. that they're not able to provide for their own food and the other necessities of life. And often food goes lacking. I'm Bob Peden, missions pastor here at Central. And I want to share with you today an opportunity we all have to get involved in feeding those who are less fortunate in the Meridian area. Once a month, some of the members of our church gather at New Life Community Church with others from the community to help package food for the food bank that is housed there at that church. The food actually comes from the Mississippi Food Network, which provides it to food banks across the state at no charge. Volunteering to help with this food bank gives us an opportunity to follow Jesus' command for our lives, to love other people as we love Him. It's a great way for us to get involved in His mission in our world. If you want to come and be a part of this, contact me ahead of time at 601-938-7868. This is an excellent way for our church to be involved in helping to feed the community here at Central.